Well, good morning, everyone, and Happy New Year's. Oh, come on. Yeah, there we go. I need a little bit of response. It makes me all self-conscious and stuff if I don't get responses. There we go. Well, my name is Chris Quinn. I'm the youth pastor here at Portland Community Church, and we're glad you are here to be with us on this New Year's. I know you could be all kinds of other places this morning. I know there's definitely some good football going on this morning. You could be at home New Year's Day watching football, but you're here with us, so thank you for doing that. And so this morning, we're going to talk about the greatest pursuit, what it is that we could be pursuing that's the greatest thing that we could be pursuing. And so I want to start with this thought. Each of us, even if you are not a Christian, each one of us has an idea in our minds about what Christianity is all about. Sometimes it's right and sometimes it's wrong. Some people would have this idea that Christianity is all about a list of rules that you need to follow in order to appease God, to make God happy. And let me tell you, if you read the book of Galatians, it'll tell you right away, no, that's not what Christianity is all about. Some people would even go the opposite direction and say, well, you know, Christianity is actually all about a freedom from rules. We have no rules on us whatsoever. We can do whatever we want and everything is okay. Well, Romans, the book of Romans talks about that. That's also not the case. But I think many of us also have this idea that when we come to Christ, when we give our lives to Jesus, that our lives are going to be made, are just going to be great. Everything's going to be good. We're going to be happy. God's purpose is to make us happy, to send us positive vibes, or however how you want to put it. But that's not what Christ came to do. That's not what Christ is all about. Christ is not necessarily all about our happiness. And if we're honest with ourselves, a lot of these ideas that we have in our minds aren't working for many of us. Christianity, for some reason, isn't working. And we have to ask the question of why. Why isn't it working for us? And a lot of it has to do with because we don't understand what it is, what it's all about. I recently read a book called The Pursuit of God by a man named A.W. Tozer. Now, if you want a light reading, don't read that book. It is a thick and heavy reading, and it's actually pretty short, but it's intense. And the whole premise around it is centered around John 17:3, which says, "Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." Tozer puts his whole book around this idea that it's all about, like Christianity is all about knowing God, knowing Christ, and it's the pursuit of knowing God and knowing Christ. So it's not just this sitting around and waiting for God to miraculously change everything about you without any of your effort. There is an effort that you have to do to pursue God. And he starts with asking the question of why we don't do that. Why don't we pursue Christ? What keeps us from doing that in a greater way? And this is what he says. And this quote will be on the screen. "Our woes began when God was forced out of his central shrine and things were allowed to enter. Within the human heart, things have taken over. Men have now, by nature, no peace within their hearts, for God is crowned there no longer. But there in the moral dusk, stubborn and aggressive usurpers fight among themselves for first place on the throne." Tozer pinpoints the problem with us allowing things and material goods or even other pursuits to take the place of God as on the central throne of our hearts. That we have allowed these things to take place, to take root, and that these things become more important than Christ. And notice what he says, that these usurpers, these things that get in the way, are stubborn and aggressive. They're hard to remove, and they don't want to be removed, because that is where our hearts naturally tend to go towards. I know in my own life, I've been following Christ for 15 years, and it is hard, even still. Sometimes I might even say it's harder even now because I'm realizing these kinds of things. And so it's becoming harder for me to push against that because of the fact that these things in my heart are so strong and stubborn because they're just so natural to us. And so we're going to look at different things of what it means to pursue Christ. And some of these things that we could be pursuing instead are things like material goods. And we could be pursuing to accumulate all kinds of things, and that's not going to bring satisfaction. That's not going to bring joy. You've all had this experience of buying a new particular thing that you're really excited about. So recently, we bought a brand new TV. And I'm a cheapskate, so I found like the cheapest possible deal I could find on like the most bare bones TV I could find that was an upgrade in technology. And so I found a great deal, bought it, and I'm telling you, within a couple weeks, the novelty of it already wore off. And in my head, I started to analyze, well, that's wrong with this particular picture in this TV, and that we do that so quickly with new things that we get. We almost immediately are dissatisfied and looking for that next thing. Constantly, this constant desire. And that's what marketing, TV marketing is all about, is creating that dissatisfaction that you need to get that next thing. Also, what we could be pursuing is this elusive idea of the American dream. You know, your dream house, the white picket fence, maybe a pet or two, or 2.5 kids. I've always heard it described as 2.5 kids. Where do they get the 2.5? I don't want half a kid. But that's what we do. We think that. But then many of us who have reached that point, that have reached that level of life where we have acquired all those things, there is still something stirring in us that we know this still isn't fulfilling us. This still isn't satisfying. Why am I not happy? Why am I not wanting? Or why am I not content with what I have? Why do I still want more? And also, for many of us, we pursue this other idea of happiness, this general idea, and we think that Christianity, like I said earlier, that Christianity, that God came and Christ came to just make us happy, just to give us whatever we want, and that we pursue this idea of doing whatever makes us happy. And actually, that's a really, really dangerous thing, because something that today can make you happy, tomorrow can make you angry. And so just as quickly as something makes you happy, you could lose the joy and the love for that thing, and the exact opposite happens. So happiness is not the greatest pursuit. That is not the thing that we need to be pursuing the most. So this morning, we're going to be looking at three reasons why Jesus himself is the greatest pursuit we could ever have, and why all those other rival pursuits are meaningless in comparison to Christ. So let's go ahead. We're going to look at Matthew chapter 16. We're going to start in verse 24. If you are not already there yet, I invite you to turn. If you don't have a Bible in your hand, I invite you to grab one of the brown hardcoverback Bibles in front of you. It's on page 983. I'll give you a minute to turn there, and I'll just explain quickly what's going on in this story. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus is having a conversation with his disciples about what it means to be a real disciple of Christ. And Jesus poses this question to Peter, and he asks him, or to all the disciples, but Peter answers. He says, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answers with, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says to him, "Correct, you are right. You are blessed, Peter, because this has been revealed to you by God, not by men." And almost immediately following, Jesus then starts to tell his disciples about how he is going to die and he is going to have to suffer for their sakes. And Peter, this is bold, Peter rebukes Jesus, the one he just called the Son of the living God, like God himself. Nice try trying to rebuke God. I don't suggest doing that whatsoever. That's not a good idea, to rebuke God. And so Peter is then told by Jesus, Jesus says to him, "Get behind me, Satan." Because Peter was telling him, "No, you're the Messiah. You're not to be crucified. You're going to set up this kingdom." So Jesus is beginning to set up this idea that the way that they thought about what it means to follow after him was going to be completely different. So this is what he's talking about here. This is how it sets up. So let's go ahead and read verses 24 and 25. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it." So Jesus says, if you want to be a follower of me, if you want to be my disciple, here's what you have to do. And the first thing he throws out there is not a popular idea. He says to deny yourself. We live in a culture that actually gives freedom and suggests the idea of permitting for self, saying, go and do whatever you want. Don't deny yourself. Allow for yourself to do whatever you feel like you want to do, whatever you think is going to make you happy. But Jesus gives the exact opposite. And I think this is one of those moments that if Jesus, for some reason, had like a PR director on his staff, that they would pull him aside and say, Jesus, you know, you don't want to say the whole deny yourself thing. That's going to get you less followers. You know, you want to say something that's going to get more people to follow you? Don't say that. Try that again. Because people don't want to hear that. People want to hear that you can go and do whatever you want and you can go find happiness in these other things. People don't want to hear deny yourself. Because deny yourself means to basically say, I reject anything that I want out of my own life and instead choose to take up whatever Jesus wants to give me in my life. It's a proverbial going against the grain of the world and saying, I deny my own desires, my own wants, my own needs, my time, my talent, my treasure, all of that is for Jesus and him alone, not me. That's not a popular thing to say. That's not a fun thing to say. And I can tell you, the longer I follow Christ, the more and more this becomes difficult and hard, because these things, like I said earlier, that Tozer said, they're stubborn and aggressive. We don't want to let go of them. But that's what we do. We deny ourselves. But then Jesus says as well, to take up your cross and follow me. To take up your cross would be a hard thing for the disciples to hear. Not only denying yourselves is hard, but taking up your cross. Because the cross is this idea of surrender, this submitting to God's will. And the Christians, or the early Christians at this time, would have been experiencing and knowing exactly what the cross was all about, what crucifixion was all about. Crucifixion was this very public display of Roman authority, basically saying, we are in charge, you are not, you will submit, that's the end of the deal. And it was to try and stifle any potential rebellion, to create fear, to basically say, you will not try and beat us, because this is what's going to happen to you. An example of this is the Spartacan rebellion. If you've heard of Spartacus, him and his men rebelled against the Roman Empire, and they eventually got defeated. And what happened is Spartacus and his men were all crucified, but they were placed along what's called the Appian Way, the main road leading into Rome. They were placed for miles upon miles out from the city, so that when people would walk in, they would look up and see all these men crucified. And it was basically saying, this is what's going to happen to you if you try and fight. If you try and beat us, this is what's going to happen to you. And the Romans were excellent at this. So the cross would create this kind of fear. But Jesus is redeeming this idea to basically say, you're submitting yourself to God. You're surrendering your will over to God. And again, this is hard for us because we want to be able to do whatever we want to do. But God is saying, and Jesus is saying in this moment, to surrender everything, to let go of control, to let go of your idea of what your life needs to be and follow Christ. And the reason we can do this is that Jesus is our prime example. Jesus did it himself. Jesus denied himself by coming to this earth in the form of a human being. It says in Philippians 2, 7 and 8 that Christ emptied himself of his godness to take on human form, to live among us and to die for us. That's how Jesus denied himself. Not only that, like, he did take up the cross. He did take up that punishment for us that we deserved. So Christ is our ultimate example of that, of what it means to deny ourselves and take up our cross. But the real reason as to why this is a good thing to do, this is the right thing to do, and this is our first reason why pursuing Jesus is the greatest pursuit you could have, is that Christ alone gives true life. You see, You look at what he says next. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. He's beginning to open up this idea that anything we pursue, anything that's not of him, are things that are not going to give us true life. Only in him, when we pursue him with our whole life, when we give ourselves to him, when we pursue him with everything that we have, will we find what true life is all about. It's in Christ. It's in him. It's not in anything else. And he gives this point of saying, if you want to try and hold on to any piece of your old self, your old life, apart from me, pursue any of those things, you will lose your real life. That's the cost. The cost is huge when Jesus opens up the opportunity for us to come to him. But let me tell you, Christ is the one who offers this true life alone. All these other things that we have, they will not be able to do it. So I want to ask this question at this moment. If Christ alone gives true life, then we need to be pursuing that. But I think oftentimes we live in that tension of, do we live in a self-permitting lifestyle where we feel like, yes, I'm going to go do whatever I want that's going to make me happy? Or do we live in self-denial saying, I'm going to give up everything in order to follow Christ? And here's a test to see if you're unsure of which side you tend to fall into. Look at how you spend your time. Look at how you spend your money, your energy, any of those things. Do you give a thought about whether or not, or what God would think about these things? Do you give a moment to say, okay, God, my life is for your glory. My life is for you. I am denying myself. God, what do I need to do? And let me tell you, before it sounds like I'm beating you over the head with this idea. The reason I'm talking about this is because this is something God has been doing in my life in the last few months, where God has really just said, this is something you need to work on. This is not something you're very good at. Let's work on this. So I'm in the middle of this, of learning this. And so we got to give a thought. We got to start thinking, okay, Jesus, what do I need to do with my life? What do I need to do that's going to give you glory? How am I going to deny myself so that I may find true life in you? Do what you are calling me to do. Instead of living in this permitting lifestyle where I just go and do whatever I want. But I want you to think of this too. If you're in the camp where you're more pursuing what you want, how's that going? Having been there many times myself, it does not satisfy. You're constantly looking. It's almost an addiction, and you have to keep trying to find something to fill that void, to fill that hole, and it's not working. It doesn't work. But let me tell you, surrendering to Christ means you will find true life. And every time I've had to re-up that commitment, that desire to say, I'm going to deny myself, I'm going to follow Christ harder than I ever have before, it's always, always worth it. It is so good. And that's what we're going to talk about next. So let's look at verse 26. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? Jesus is basically asking this question at this point. Is losing your soul worth gaining everything in this life? Because that's what's going to happen. If you pursue this world, you pursue the passions and the possessions of this life, that's what's going to happen. You're going to lose your soul. You're going to lose that true life. But if you give, like I said, of everything, you will find the true life. And I think part of the reason we struggle with really wanting to give ourselves to Christ instead of giving ourselves to the world is that we don't understand the beauty and the value of what we have been given in Christ. Matthew 13:44 says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field." And I think for many of us, we would approach and find that treasure in the field. And we would have that idea of Christianity, those different ideas of Christianity in our head. And part of the reason probably why we struggle is we look at that treasure and we don't see it as valuable enough. We don't see it as worthy enough, as good enough. And so that's why we struggle, because we're not willing to give up anything because it's not truly valuable. This idea of trying to just follow the rules, that's not something that sounds too enjoyable or valuable, or a freedom from rules to do whatever you want. Well, that's just going to lead me to be dissatisfied because I'm never going to be fulfilled. And as well with happiness, I'm never, like, these things can't make me happy. So what am I looking for? But if we truly came to that field and saw what Christianity was all about, what Jesus really came to do, that there is a God who created all of this world simply by speaking it into existence. And this all-powerful God made himself small by becoming a human, taking on human flesh, died on the cross for our sins on our behalf because he lived a perfect life, And then, not only that, rose again from the dead so that we could be raised to new life as well, that we could enter into that kind of holiness and relationship with Christ. That sounds like a much greater treasure than whatever other ideas that we might have, and that's why we pursue. So that's our second reason why we pursue Christ, is that Christ, the life Christ gives is far more valuable than anything else. You might pursue all that stuff. You might get everything you ever want, but it'll never satisfy. It'll never give you the kind of peace and joy and contentment that you're looking for. Only Christ can do that. Because in Christ, because he died on the cross to forgive us of our sins, there is no reason to feel condemnation. There's no reason to feel guilt because the debt has been paid for. It's taken care of. It's done. And then also the hope that Christ is giving us new life through his resurrection. That is an amazing treasure and an amazing hope. So I want to encourage you that maybe it's part of the reason why we struggle in our relationship with Christ is because we don't see Christ as valuable enough. I've also been reading this book slowly because it's a philosophical kind of book. And so you have to read like 5 pages and then think about it for like 2 weeks. It's that kind of book. It's just really thick. It's called You Are What You Love. It's by a man named James K.A. Smith. And his basic point behind it is that we have believed this idea that human beings are simply brains on a stick. That as long as they think the right things, they will act in the right way. But I think if we take inventory of ourselves for, 5 minutes, we'll realize that we don't do that. We might all have ideas of what we think in our head, this is the way what I'm supposed to do in this particular situation. But then when we get to that situation, we act totally to the contrary. We all do it. I do it. I'm a human being. And here's why we do those kind of things. It's because there is a competing love that is in our hearts that we love more than Christ. And so the point of the book is to say, you act out based on what you love, based on what you find valuable, based on what, on how you view the good life, what you see as the right kind of life. So my challenge for all of us is, if we're struggling, take a moment to really look at what the gospel teaches about what Jesus did for us and see that it is truly and much more valuable than anything else that this world can offer. Because all that stuff is temporary. It lasts, it's fleeting, but it passes away so quick. But Christ's story, love story for us does not ever pass away. Never does. And here's the thing. Choosing to live for the pursuits of this world, it's like being offered a castle but choosing to live in the landfill. You might be in the landfill and you might see a couple shiny things that are fun to play with, that you might enjoy, but it's not the ultimate place, ultimate reality of what you could be living in. To live with Christ is so much better than anything else. And I may be young. I just turned 30 in 2016. But I've seen enough to know that pursuing other things doesn't bring satisfaction. That's actually my testimony of how I came to Christ in the first place. When I was 15 years old, I was pursuing 3 main things. I was pursuing popularity. I was pursuing being a basketball star, which didn't work out, obviously. And girls, okay? I was 15. What else was I going to pursue? Okay? Those 3 things, and all 3 of those things within my freshman year of high school completely fell apart and failed miserably, okay? It was a hard year, but it was in that moment that God began to speak to me, and he said to me, Chris, you're pursuing your life. You're pursuing what you want. I have something that's greater. Give your life to me. Stop fighting me and just surrender. And I did. I said, yeah, you know what? I believe it. I'm going to follow it. And even over the 15 years, and this is a constant thing, even over 15 years, there have been moments where I've had to re-up that commitment to go, okay, I've made this commitment. I'm realizing again, I'm pursuing my life, not Christ. God, I have to give that up. I have to move on. I have to let it go. because what you have for me is so much better. And I don't regret every time, even though there's been things that I've had to lose, there have been things that I have gained that have been so much better. And I'm not talking about even possessions or relationships. I'm just talking about Jesus himself. Growing to a greater knowledge of Christ is so much better than anything that this world could give me. Even though God has blessed me with some amazing things in this life. So let's look at verse 27. For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what they have done. So here's the third reason. The third reason why Christ is the greatest pursuit we could ever have is because Christ's reward is based on whether we know him or not. So you want to have that great reward of seeing God in all his glory, spend time in eternity with God for forever? The standard is to know him. Jesus describes this whole scenario of coming before God later in Matthew as separating the sheep from the goats. And the distinction between the sheep and the goats is whether they knew him. The goats say, oh, Jesus, we did all these amazing things for you. We fed people. We clothed people. We healed people. All in your name. And Jesus says, I reject you because I didn't know you. But with the sheep, they did all the same things. But they knew him. They know him. So if we want to spend eternity with Christ, you have to know him. You can't just have this intellectual idea in your head that you agree with the idea of what Christianity teaches about the gospel, but you have to seek to pursue to know God. And it's got to be in tangible ways that you do it. And you might think in your mind, well, if I pursue God and I start doing those things, I'm going to start looking pretty silly. Yeah, you probably will, according to the world, because the New Testament writers are very clear about this. They say this all the time. Christianity is foolishness to the rest of the world. Denying yourself, taking up your cross, that's ridiculous. You're supposed to go and live and do whatever you want. That's a ridiculous idea to go and deny yourself. That's what the world would think. So of course you're going to look silly. But the thing that's got to hold on to us, that's got to keep us going in that mindset, is that we know what we have is far more valuable than anything else that they could have in their life. That's the standard. And so I'll give you this suggestion, because one of the things that James Smith says in his book about how to reorient your loves, and you know, you have these other loves in your heart, and that's why you pursue those things other than Christ. The main point of the book is actually to say, you got to rework some habits. You know, sometimes we have these habits where we might come home from a hard day at work, and, you know, I've done this many times, and we want to plop down on the couch or in our lovely recliner and turn on the TV and just veg out for the night. Let me tell you, that's very tempting, like all the time, okay, to do that, because work is hard, and so you're looking to relax. But what if you started working different habits into your life, into your day, where you maybe even start in the morning and say, I'm going to read my Bible first thing in the morning. Or when I come home from work, I'm going to take 5 to 10 minutes just to decompress from my day, talk to God, and let him into my space of what I'm thinking about and what I'm dealing with. And let me tell you, habits start small. If you start with saying, oh, I'm going to do a 40-minute a day Bible reading plan, you're going to fail probably within the first week. But if you start with something small, 5, 10 minutes a day, it'll really help. And sometimes a major block for us is that we don't understand what the Bible is saying. So let me give you a really great tip about trying to understand the Bible. We've been doing this the last 4 months with the youth. It's called the Bible Project, and they really like it, okay? Where we have a Bible reading plan that we do, and they actually have an app on your smartphones called Read Scripture that put together a reading plan for you to do over the next year, so you could start it today. But not only that, with the reading plans, they have videos that explain every single book of the Bible. That's what they worked on for the last year. They did all 66 books of the Bible, 72 8-minute videos, animated explanations of what each book of the Bible is talking about and what it's trying to say. So if you ever come to a book, you might come to a book like Hebrews and you just go, I read it, sounded nice, no idea what it was talking about. Okay? It's a very normal experience. You go onto YouTube, type in your search bar, the Bible Project, you pull up their page and you find it. You find that they have a video. On that Read Scripture app, it's all there. They put it out there right for you. Okay, so you could do that. You could also start a practice of journaling. This is something, not just, you know, these things are good that you get, and we have new ones, by the way, so grab those on your way out. But you do a Bible study. Do those. Those are helpful because it asks you questions as you're reading, and so you start to really think about what it's talking about. But maybe also have a journal that where you just write out your thoughts unfiltered. You know, your handwriting might start to look kind of crazy because you're just writing unfiltered thoughts, but it's something that has been huge in my life, very helpful to get my thoughts out because sometimes they get trapped and get stuck and I need to get them out. Another habit you could start to practice is to worship, to spend time in worship with God. So you could, you know, find a place where you can be by yourself, turn on some worship music and genuinely worship with it. And sing out to God, you know, in a private, quiet place to yourself. And I know that's probably hard for many of you because you've got kids that are demanding of your attention, but try and get, 5 minutes, something, to start this up. And so this morning, I didn't really want to have a lot of next steps because I think overall, we need to look at what we talked about this morning is through one idea, and that's, I will pursue after Christ more than ever before. Let that be, and if that's something that's resonating with you this morning, that you're sensing, this is what I need to do, write that down on the communication card when you get ready to pass it in, right? I will pursue after Christ more than ever before. And I'm not talking about just in 2017. I'm talking about that you're going to look at it every day. I'm going to pursue Christ more each and every day so that by the time my life here on earth is done, I can look at Christ and truly say, I know you. And that he would look back at you and say, I know you. I know who you are and I know your heart. So remember what John said. What John wrote, what Jesus said. Now, this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. So ask yourself this question. Do you know him? And if you don't, pursue after Christ so that you can know him. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for your word that opens up our hearts. But God, opens up an opportunity for us to know you. God, we know that your grace is so great that not only do you forgive us, but you open up the door for us continually to come to you, to pursue after you, to know you. God, we thank you for that, that that is always open and is always available. God, we don't deserve it, but God, you still give it. So God, we thank you for that. And God, we pray that we would be people that would pursue after you more than ever before this next year. God, to live the life that you have designed us to live, to find the true life. God, may we pursue you in this, not only this next year, but for the rest of our lives. And we pray this all in your name. Amen.